Right. Thank you. Thank you, madam. Thank you for the Sri Lanka Medical Association and for giving this opportunity for us to talk to for the young doctors. And my topic is ophthalmology as a career. Is it a choice for you? I think yes. I will tell you what the reasons. And before telling you this, I would say that I am the president-elect in College of Ophthalmologists of Sri Lanka, and I have been the president in the Association of Vitreoretina Association in Sri Lanka. So that, I will take you how you, from your house officer to become a specialist, the pathway in ophthalmology. Before telling you how to reach that position, I will tell you why you should be advantageous in ophthalmology. One reason is this is both surgical and medical field, right? You if you want to work with the surgical aspect, yes, you are there. And if you want to do medical things, yes, you are there. And if you want to do research, of course, Avenue is there. They know ophthalmologists allowed to be including trainees, go ahead without research components. So everything is there. And the other thing is that you are always using with microsurgical instruments, microscopes and all that. So there is a highly sophisticated machines that you are using. So you have to be keeping up to date about this physics and all that. So your brain is always working. You hardly go, you won't develop Alzheimer's disease, don't worry. And the other thing is that many people are very happy with the flexible working hours now. I heard this morning, Professor Nandadeva said, if you want to do the surgery, well, you have to have a nice wife or a nice husband. In this case, don't worry, you can have your own choice, whether the wife is nice or not, you can work because you can decide when to do your surgical or your practice. But it doesn't mean that you can compromise the patient's your service, but you know, you can adjust. Those are not very ophthalmic emergencies, only very few in the field. So you can decide when to work. And when you become an ophthalmologist, there are many subspecialities that you can select, namely retina specialists. Even in the retina specialist, you can become a surgical retina specialist or a medical retina specialist. And then glaucoma specialists with the pediatric ophthalmologists, neuro-ophthalmologists, oculoplastic and orbit, refractive surgeon. So there's a huge range of subspecialities which are all everybody has got enough work to do even in this country. Of course, in the world, it is much more. And the job satisfaction, of course, this is, if you go to the internet and see that the most satisfied professionals, the ophthalmologists are on the top of the list. They are very happy. One reason is flexible hours of working. Your patients are happy and you can choose. Suppose you are going to be an ophthalmologist, so suddenly you find your hand skills are not good, but still getting away from surgery, but you can do the ophthalmic medical practice. So therefore you have a choice there, even later stages. So therefore everybody is happy in the field. At the same time, it is very lucrative. And Nilmini this morning said, your Anna consultant, Anna Satis, who is working with me, actually she said, don't look at the monetary aspect of your profession. Of course, I totally agree with her. But on the other hand, if you are not having enough money to live today, you know, it is very difficult for you to be happy. You will be struggling with your family and all that. Therefore, you need some amount of money. It doesn't mean that you should go behind the money. Of course, in this profession, if your work is good, the money will come behind you. Well, any field, anything, there is advantages as well as disadvantages. One major disadvantage in this field is very competitive. It is not in the Sri Lanka itself, but even in other countries, it is not easy. Usually in Sri Lanka, the top top group of the merit list come for us at the moment. And it is very challenging, challenging in the sense, you know, the patient's demand are very high. Patient's expectations are very high. And the results are then and there. You know, if you do a laparotomy or something or other surgeries, of course, there are healing process, take time, and you can, of course, get away. Even if you do something, you can always, there is a chance to correct, but here it is not like that. If you make a mistake, I mean, the chances of recovery is not that easy like in other fields. I'm not saying that the other fields are not challenging, but you know, this is more challenging in view of ophthalmology. So you'll have to be very careful in your practice. And you know, if you damage one eye, the whole family is finished. The breadwinner's family is like that. I mean, very, very challenging field when it comes to work. And more than that, the continuous medical education in this field is very important. You know, a few years back, it was the computer science and ophthalmology was equally developing at one space, you know, one phase. So today a machine comes and 2 years time that machine is out of the practice. So we'll have to go for something. And we also have to learn that. So, you know, so therefore, and in addition to the practice pattern as well, is changing very rapidly. You know, one drug is available today, but in 2 years time, it's totally different. So it's fast developing field and you have to be up to date in the field. Otherwise, it's not easy. Well, how to become an ophthalmologist? You are happy to become an ophthalmologist. How to become in the PGIM part? What is the path? You have to do your post-intern one year. After the internship, you have to do post-intern any place. It's all right. 1 year post-intern to sit for the selection exams. Then after the selection exam, then another 1 year training to sit for the next exam in one of the ophthalmic unit. The selection exam is basic sciences, that is basic anatomy, only head and neck, then pathology, general pathology, and then bit of a microbiology and pharmacology, and then statistics. Those are small areas, general thing, and then physiology, of course, general physiology, excluding reproductive system, excluding. So all those things, that is general pathology, general anatomy, head and neck, and your physiology, plus basic pharmacology and microbiology. So with that, you can get into the training program. So you have to sit for the selection exam. But very likely from next year onward, we are going to change the selection exam to a common system where MS surgery, MS ophthalmology, and ENT, everything will be sitting for the same kind of an exam, and that will be different. At the moment, I'm in the committee, but I'm not in a position to explain you because still it's formatting. And then you see after 1 year of selection exam, after you do so the module 2 exam, there are real ophthalmic anatomy, anatomy of the eye, physiology of the eye related things, and pathology related to the eye comes in that module 2. Once you pass that is 1 year after selection exam, you sit for the module 2. Once you get through, you start your real ophthalmology, clinical ophthalmology appointments, which is known as registrar period. You have 4 registrar appointments, 6 months, 6 months, 6 months, like in general surgery. Within that period, you are undergoing various surgical development of surgical skills as well as theory to become eligible to sit for the MD module. At the same time, in between that, after 1 year of module 2, while you are getting ready for your final exam MD, you have a module 3, that is basically refractive module, where you practice your spectacles and all that. So your refractive module in between you comes, you have to get through that module to sit for the MD. So basically, you have 4 exams which are not difficult, except the selection exam. Of course, selection exam is not difficult, but very, very competitive. We can only take about 15 people at the moment, according to the ministry guidelines. We do not say limit the number, but it is decided by the Ministry of Health, depending on the requirement of the country. Of course, the requirement is much more than the amount that is at the moment in the country, but unfortunately, it is very difficult for us to, our economy to support all the people who are, if we increase the numbers. And then you sit for the module 2 exams. Once you finish your module 2 exam, it's like general surgery, and then once you finish your module 2 exam, there are 2 more years of post MD, 1 year, just like in other exams, 1 year local exam, local training, and 1 year overseas training. In the overseas training, it's not that difficult to get for you jobs, and many people try to stay when they go there. Of course, future, there will be a lot of jobs even in the other countries. And if you want to go to a subspecialty like retina or pediatric, you have to spend another 1 year, that is 3 years post MD. So altogether, if you want to become a subspecialty specialist, like me, a retina specialist, then you have to spend about 6 years for the whole course. But if you want to become a general ophthalmologist, you can finish it within 3 years from the entry exams, after the entry exam. So with that, you can become a board certified subspecialty expert or consultant ophthalmologist in general ophthalmology. But again, in the next year onwards, probably we are going to change according to the ministry and the PGIM guidelines. We are in the process of converting it to a consultant ophthalmologist with a special interest in something like a special interest in glaucoma, special interest in the orbit and oculoplastic, but retina and the pediatric ophthalmology will remain same, board certified in retina specialist, board certified in pediatric ophthalmology, but other subspecialties I told you, cornea specialist, orbit and oculoplastic, neuro ophthalmology, those things will be with special interest. I mean, there's a general surgery also trying to go in that pathway, so we also will follow the same pathway, but still you will have to spend 3 years on that, even with the specialist interest. So that's how the pathway for you to come to this level. So any questions, I'm happy to answer you.
So far, there are no questions.
Yes.
Dr. Salvin, yes, thank you. There is a question.
Yes. Sir, so if one is studying... Yeah, I can see. I'll read it.
You can see.
Yes. If one is studying to enter the ophthalmology PG in January 21, do we have to study for the common surgery exams? Or no, at the moment, I cannot give you 100% guarantee, but very, very likely, 90% guarantee that we are going to have the same system that we had earlier. That is, we are going to have ophthalmology entry exam alone next year, January 21. Next year, because we have not finalized the common exams yet, but PGIM is in the process of going. Anytime it can change, but even if it changes, it's not big difference from general ophthalmology entry exam and surgical exam. You have to study a little bit more anatomy on the lower part of the body. The next question, studying. What is the possibility of working in periphery as an ophthalmologist? Of course, you will have to work in the periphery, but don't worry whether you work in the periphery or Colombo, it is not much of a difference, because you will have to setting up a unit is very difficult. The government is providing for the unit because the demand is so high, or for your basic requirements will be provided there, whether you work in the National Eye Hospital in Colombo Theatre or Ampara Hospital or Ambulatory Hospital. There is no big difference in your working environment, so you can adapt that. And in addition to that, there is a lot of support from our college as well as from the retina specialist. There are even funding supports we give to encourage the encourage young ophthalmologists in the periphery. Next question is, it is a must to do a surgery? No, there is no such thing. You can do anything, internship, you can, but is our requirement is not the internship, but of course you have to complete the internship, but post-intern 1 year, you have to wait. You can do anything for your internship.
I think you answered this question. We have to sit for the common surgery exam to be able to.
Yeah, yeah, sir. At the moment, yes. At the moment, you have to sit for.
If you choose ophthalmology, which stream we should select, surgery or medicine, or is it a separate stream? I think maybe the postgraduate primary part one exams.
Yes. There is nothing called surgery, but if the common exam comes, there you will be guided how to give your choice. I'm not going to explain you that. At the moment, if you want to do, you can do anything for internship. You just sit for the ophthalmology selection exam. There is nothing called surgery or medicine like that. You can do anything for the internships as well.
I think you gave a satisfactory answers to all the questions. Thank you very much, Dr. Salvin.
Thank you.